So welcome to our last session, session four on the book of Ruth. And before we jump into the text, why don't we open with a word of prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we come into your presence this afternoon with grateful hearts for this day, for your presence among us, for the gift of this community and this time together. As always, we ask, Lord, for wisdom and insight as we study your word. We know that it is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. And we pray that we would experience the transformational power of your word as we study, as we reflect together, and as we seek to grow in our knowledge of you, of ourselves, of your world, and as we seek to be more and more the people of God that you have called us and formed us to be. All this we ask in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 All right, so as I said, I'd like to spend about the first 45 or 50 minutes of our time finishing up the book of Ruth, and then talking about where we will go next in the seasons of Advent and Epiphany. So we are in chapter four, and before we get into that, just a couple of opening comments. First of all, to go back to last week, Ian has been jumping into the Hebrew text a bit, and he got me thinking about this word cloak. I remember our discussion last week about the word cloak, and at the end of chapter three, Boaz instructs Ruth to open her cloak, and he fills it with grain. And that Ian pointed out that it's not the same word as was earlier in the chapter when Ruth says, "Cover me with your cloak." Is that right, Ian?
Yeah. That's right.
So I looked back at those words, and what I discovered, and maybe you saw this too, Ian, that back in chapter two, when Boaz blesses Ruth and says, "You've come to the Lord to be sheltered under his wings." Remember that image in chapter two? The word for wings and the word for cloak in chapter three are the same word. So I thought that was interesting. They can be translated sort of the shelter of like the shelter provided by wings, or the covering provided by a cloak or a blanket. And so that just reinforces what we've been talking about, that these human characters in so many ways embody these divine attributes that are prayed for or kind of called upon in these blessings. So I thought that was an interesting connection to our discussion last week. So today in chapter four, again, if we were hearing this story in its ancient context, we would be on the edge of our seats, because at the end of chapter three, it is revealed that not only is Boaz a kinsman redeemer, but there is someone who is closer in the lineage to Naomi, and therefore has the right of first refusal, if you will, when it comes to being the redeemer and claiming this for himself. So as we get into chapter four, we're going to see the encounter between Boaz and this next of kin who is not named in the text. And again, if you're the reader not knowing how the story ends, you're anticipating what this encounter is going to be and what is going to happen next. Any other comments or reflections on the previous three chapters before we get into chapter four? We're ready? All right, will someone read chapter four, verses 1-6? Go ahead, Kathy.
Meanwhile, Boaz went up to the town gate and sat there. And when the kinsman redeemer he had mentioned came along, Boaz said, "Come over here, my friend, and sit down." So he went over and sat down. Boaz took 10 of the elders of the town and said, "Sit here," and they did so. Then he said to the kinsman redeemer, "Naomi, who has come back from Moab, is selling the piece of land that belonged to our brother Elimelech. I thought I should bring the matter to your attention and suggest that you buy it in the presence of these seated here, and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you'll redeem it, do so. But if you will not, tell me, so I will know, for no one has the right to do it except you, and I am next in line. I will redeem it, he said. Then Boaz said, on the day you buy the land from Naomi and from Ruth, the Moabitess, you acquire the dead man's widow in order to maintain the name of the dead with his property. At this, the kinsman redeemer said, then I cannot redeem it because I might endanger my own estate. You redeem it yourself. I cannot do it. Now, in earlier times in Israel...
No, that's good. We'll stop there. That's good. I was just taking care of a few technical things. Look, we keep growing. This is great. I look down at my text and up pops all these new folks, which is wonderful. All right. Thank you, Kathy, so much. Couple of interesting things going on in just these first six chapters. The King James says that when Boaz goes up to the gate, behold, the other redeemer, the other kinsman appears, and it's a form of the word, but it kind of fits with these other things that have happened in the story that are sort of by chance, but they're not by chance, right? Like when Ruth goes out and she happens to be in the same field as Boaz, and you know when she goes to the threshing floor, and so. In the midst of these very human events, there are these glimpses of providence breaking in. So Boaz goes to the gate, which would have been the public place. We're going to learn later in the narrative that there's a crowd. The elders are there. This is where public ceremonies, debates, legal disputes would have been resolved, and so forth. So he goes to the gate, and there is where he encounters the next of kin, the Goal, that Boaz himself is, but this other one is a bit closer. He's not named, and I just want to encourage all of us when we're reading scripture, really pay attention to the characters that are named and that are not named. So he just sort of appears, and then he will disappear. Another interesting thing is that we learned that Naomi apparently has a piece of property, which is interesting because if she had property, why did she send Ruth out to glean, right? Because, you know, if she had property, she could have sold it. She could have done something with that as opposed to just sort of being relatively destitute and relying on the graciousness of Boaz. So a couple things I read this week. One is that, you know, perhaps she's already sold it and this is an opportunity for the Redeemer to buy it back, which certainly would have fit within the legal paradigm. Another scholar surmises that maybe this is a ruse, right? That this is Boaz trying to you know, get his attention, to get him interested in this. Because then the minute he says, oh, but there's a widow involved that you'd also have to marry, all of a sudden he's got other issues, right? This is going to interfere with his inheritance or whatever, and he's not able to do it. So I kind of like the second option. That sort of fits the character of Boaz, I think. He seems pretty shrewd. He knows what he's doing. He's an honorable man, but I think he's also, you know, wise and knows how to work this, if you will. Other thoughts, those were just sort of my initial reactions in the first six verses.
Well, I was gonna say, you know, you've talked, you know, throughout this reading, you know, who's most in need of redemption right now? Well, Ruth 4:4, the word Ga'al is used five times in that one verse.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of redemption going on.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And that's something we miss in English so much, that the word for redeemer and the word for next of kin are the same word, and then the the verb for redeem is the same root. And so if you're reading this in Hebrew, you're coming across this root over and over again in chapter 4. Absolutely. Yeah.
As far as the land goes, is it possible that a woman couldn't own land, or and certainly she couldn't have planted it and expected any harvest in an amount of time that would feed them?
Yeah, it says Naomi, who has come back from the country of Moab, is selling a parcel of land that belonged to our kinsman Elimelech. So, I don't know what the legal structure would have been around that, whether she would have inherited it or obligated to sell it. But that's a great question.
Which makes sense when you talk about why Ruth went out to glean, because Naomi knew that she would, that the land would have to be bought by a relative, and that wasn't going to redeem them in and of itself. She needed Boaz.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the other thing that Boaz does is connect the redemption of the land with the requirement to marry the widow, or in this case, the widow's daughter-in-law. Those two are not connected in the legal code. In other words, there's a requirement to, or at least the option to redeem the land. And then we talked about levirate marriage, you know, where the brother of a man who had died would be required to marry the widow. We don't know how far that would have extended, but this would have been quite far, because this is Naomi's relative, right? And we're talking about her daughter-in-law. So whether there would have been any legal requirement to marry the daughter-in-law, or, you know, so it gets a bit complicated. But Boaz, maybe in his shrewdness, you know, connects those two, and that's what scares him off, right? And what do you think Boaz's motivations are here? Does he just want the land, or is this
the babe?
What's that?
He wants the babe.
He wants the babe.
What we don't know is, did Boaz have another wife? We have no idea if he had children that were in her inheritance. And then the other thing I find interesting is, this is 20 years later, and now the land is up for sale. So the land that belonged to Naomi's husband has either never been tilled, or it was rented out to other people, so that if it were rented, if someone was tilling the soil, Naomi should have money. But the passage clearly implies that Naomi is selling the land because she needs sustenance, money to live on.
Right.
So
yeah, that's the implication for sure. Yeah.
For sure. And you know, it's if we, not knowing the other side, the unknown side to this is, you know, what is the state of Boaz? He apparently does not have the same problem that the first in line has. Because the first in line, as we read on later, he doesn't think he can afford to take the wife and reduce the inheritance to his present family. So he obviously already has a wife and family, whereas we don't have any idea what Boaz's state is.
Yeah. Well, one thing I was thinking about as I read chapter 4, and maybe I'm reading too much into this, but it seems like chapter 1 is full of emotion, right? There's grief, there's loss, there's tension between mother-in-law and daughter-in-law, and then this very emotive response on the part of Ruth to her mother-in-law. Chapter 2 seems very pragmatic, right? Ruth goes out in the field, there's this exchange, there's supplies that are given, you know. Chapter 3 seems, again, full of emotion, right? There's, or at least, you know, there's there's sexual innuendo, and there's all of this relational stuff going on. Now in chapter four, when we get to the climax, again, it feels very, very mundane, right? They're just dealing with these different agreements. And even when we get into the marriage part, it doesn't seem to be the affection that we felt in chapter three. So I don't know what to make of that, if that's an intentional pattern in the book or not, but certainly a lot going on in terms of these legal options that were on the table. And we don't know enough about all of them to piece them all together exactly. But certainly I think my reading, and it seems like the consensus of the group, is Boaz is really working it here to sort of make sure he remains the one who is able to marry Ruth and pursue this opportunity, you know? And I think going back to chapter three, he really cares for Ruth and he really wants to see this through. And he said that, right? If this next kin doesn't accept, I will do it, right? So he makes his intentions known very clearly. All right, well, someone pick up verse 7 through 12, 7 through 12.
I'll
wave their hand.
Right.
Emily, go ahead, Emily.
Okay, 7 through 12.
7 through 12.
Now, this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging. To confirm a transaction, the one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other, and this was the manner of attesting in Israel. So when the next of kin said to Boaz, "Buy it for yourself," he drew off his sandal. Then Boaz said to the elders and all the people, "You are witnesses this day that I have bought from the hand of Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion and to the Mahlon, also Ruth and the Moabites, the widow of Mahlon. I have bought to my wife to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among the brethren and from the gate of his native place. You are witnesses this day." And all the people who were at the gate and the elders said, "We are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. May you prosper in Ephrathah and be renowned in Bethlehem. And may your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah, because of all the children that the Lord will give you by this young woman." Is that it?
Perfect. That's great. Yeah, thank you so much, Emily. So here's one of these customs that we don't know a lot about, the taking off of one's sandal as a sort of confirmation of a transaction. So we're told that the one took off a sandal and gave it to the other. This was the manner of attesting in Israel. So when the next of kin said to Boaz, "Acquire it for yourself," he took off his sandal.
Aren't shoes really big in the Middle East today? Because you see them, you know, like that last thing they had the footprints on the I can't even remember what happened just a couple of weeks ago.
There's a random, I didn't take the time to look it up. It's somewhere in I think Deuteronomy, where a sandal is taken off kind of as an act of protest, but that doesn't seem to be what's happening here. This is actually a sign of, you know, sort of the transaction being agreed upon. So, Marilyn?
Yeah, I relate it back to Moses and the burning bush. Take off your sandal, for you stand on holy ground.
Interesting.
And this could sanctify the exchange.
Ah, that's good.
Now, I was going to say,
yeah, go ahead, Ian.
This took me back to Abraham. So this taking off from the sandal, and remember, he's assembled these 10 elders at the city gate to witness this. This means it's really official. And I don't know if you remember this from Genesis, but in order to show that really this Canaan was supposed to be land that the children of Israel had as a legitimate inheritance. Abraham went to buy it from the local guy, and he tried to put him off and say, well, what is it? What is, 10,000 whatever between friends like us? And he named a huge price, an exorbitant price for the land. And Abraham paid it in front of everybody. And that made it absolutely 100% official. The fact that he had paid the asking price, which everybody knew was highly inflated. And this, to me, reminded me of that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I also think what's going on here, not just with the sandal, but with the line where it says, today you are witnesses, the elders and the people who have gathered, because, as we know, having read the whole narrative, the big reveal is going to be that this lineage that starts here is going to produce David, right? Again, the reader doesn't know that, but they're setting it up to legitimate this relationship between Boaz and Ruth. So the other kinsman redeemer and the author, the narrator, seems to know that they may not be familiar with this, because he actually says, this was a custom in ancient times. He doesn't assume that the reader knows what this is, and so the narrator takes some time to introduce it. But I think that he is trying to make sure that there's no doubt that the other kinsman redeemer abdicated, his potential role as redeemer, and that there were multitude of witnesses that saw it and that witnessed the joining of Boaz and Ruth. You know what I mean? So that it really makes this official and legitimate, so that there be no question about sort of the lineage that will be articulated later in the book. That was kind of my take on it. Well, I love all these connections. That's awesome. I mean, Abraham and Moses and the law in Deuteronomy, I think there might be parts of all of those that connect back to this.
When I read through this, my take on the fact that he's at with the gate and he had witnesses when the first in line rejected the redemption, becoming the redeemer. So anything forward, if there were a dispute between the two of them, Boaz would always be on solid ground, saying, it was offered, you refused. That property now is mine, uncontested, because he has a firm refusal of right. The first in line, which is key to what you pass down.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. Yeah. Now, I really want you to pay attention to the role of blessings in this book. There's a moment where Boaz in chapter 2 blesses Ruth, Naomi blesses Boaz. Now we get the assembly that proclaim in verse 11, we are witnesses. And then there is this blessing, may the Lord make the woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, which of course were the matriarchs and the mothers of the 12 tribes of Israel, for the most part, who together built up the house of Israel. There's the reference. May you produce children in Ephrathah and bestow a name in Bethlehem. And through the children that the Lord will give you by this young woman, may your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah. Right? Now, again, we're talking about grace. And anybody listening to this, again, I think they would have gasped a little bit when they heard, may your house be like Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah, right? Because if you know the story here, Judah had two sons. Tamar married the oldest son. He died. Through levirate marriage, the other son married Tamar. He died. Judah's wife died, so he's a widower. There's no children. So Tamar dresses up as a prostitute and seduces Judah and actually leaves some clues or you know, implicates him so that later on when Judah finds out that she's pregnant, those clues tell him that he's the father, right? Anyway, so this huge scandal, right, in Genesis, I think chapter 30 something, with Judah and Tamar, produces Perez. And when we get to the genealogy in verse 18, they start the genealogy with Perez, right? So this whole thing is so complicated and convoluted. You've got this basically incestuous relationship between Tamar and Judah that produces Perez. Then you've got a daughter-in-law, Ruth, who's not a blood relative, marrying the Redeemer. So I guess what strikes me is grace is showered upon all of the most unlikely, unexpected characters in this whole story, starting with Tamar and Judah all the way through with Ruth. Any reflections on that? Does that make sense? I mean, it should be pretty shocking to us when we read these characters, that none of whom are really upstanding, righteous individuals, right?
Well,
that's what you said.
It's interesting because I, in my notations, in the this version of the Bible, they talk about Naomi and Boaz, and it says Boaz and Ruth were the great grandparents of King David and the ancestor of Jesus. But Boaz, as in fact mother, was a prostitute.
I wonder where they get that.
Well, Boaz was the son of Rahab, a former in Joshua 2. That's where they got the prostitute from.
Interesting. I don't know if I've ever made that connection.
Yeah.
I wonder if that's standard or not.
Interesting. So if you think about it, there's a lot of diversity in the lineage of David, because he's got Boaz is part of that lineage. And so is Ruth, who is a non-Jew. So he has a very good, very interesting lineage.
Well, and this goes back to our definition of grace for this book, right? Mercy, not merit. Right. And unlike Jonah, where the Ninevites, even though they cry out to Yahweh and repent, there's no implication that they become Israelites. They don't join the Israelites. They're still Ninevites and Assyrians. So that's a story about God's grace being extended even to our enemies, those that we would otherwise reject. This is a story about God's grace within the family of God, right? All of these people that are pretty messed up, God uses in some way to bring about his purposes. And so I think that's a distinction for me in terms of how we read these through the lens of grace. Yeah, Marilyn.
Yeah. Well, I see it also as extending grace to foreigners. I mean, if Boaz's mother was a foreigner and Ruth is a foreigner, and wasn't Tamar a foreigner also?
I don't know. I'd have to look that up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is a way of saying, if particularly depending on when this was written, and I think it was written at a time when they were being told to get rid of their foreign wives, mm-hmm. This would be a very clear message to extend grace to the other.
Yeah, and I didn't bring this up, but I think you're absolutely right. Remember in chapter 3, as the relationship between Boaz and Ruth develops, the description of Ruth as a Moabite or a foreigner sort of drops off in chapter 3. It's back in chapter 4. Mm-hmm. And I think it serves two purposes. One, in the exchange between Boaz and the other kinsman redeemer, again, it's part of Boaz's way of sort of you know, do you really want to marry Ruth the Moabite, right? Do you want to get yourself into that? So it's part of his ruse to kind of, you know, get the other guy to back off. But then in the very next scene at the actual marriage, she's still described as the Moabite. So I think it reinforces that Boaz is knowingly entering into this this relationship, this marriage with a foreign wife. I think that's part of the what is being emphasized there. Yeah, Ian.
Yeah, and since you've mentioned the whole Tamar thing, and I'd forgotten of her sordid history, this really could be a celebration of chutzpah. I mean, Tamar, if nothing else, had chutzpah. And in a way, and it, obviously not in a shocking a way, but so do Naomi and Ruth. So this, to use the current lingo in our own culture, women who have agency are being celebrated here.
Yeah. Well, and there's a connection there because I reread some commentaries on chapter 3, and most people seem to agree that, you know, in the ancient world, a marriage was consummated through the sexual union, right? That's what made the marriage official, if you will. And so, you know, most scholars think that Ruth is going in there to basically seduce Boaz into that and then say, oh, and by the way, you're the redeemer, right? Now, I think if you read carefully chapter 3, that doesn't happen because Boaz is a man of honor and he pursues it based on his honor and his sense of obligation as opposed to Ruth having already seduced him. But if that's the reading of chapter 3, then it fits very much with the Tamar story and others that precede Ruth in terms of the women taking matters into their own hands and they seem to know the law better than the men do sometimes in terms of what the obligations would be and the ramifications would be. So that's good. That's good. All right, 13 through 17. Will someone read 13 through 17?
I will.
Go ahead. Kate, can you read it?
So Boaz married Ruth and took her home to live
with her.
Can't hear you. I'm sorry, Kate. I hear you before.
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
Oh. So Boaz married Ruth and took her home to live with him. When he slept with her, the Lord enabled her to become pregnant, and she gave birth to a son. And the women of the town said to Naomi, "Praise the Lord who has given you a family redeemer today. May he be famous in Israel. May this child restore your youth and care for you in your old age. For he is the son of your daughter-in-law who loves you so much and who has been better to you than seven sons." Naomi took care of the baby and cared for him as if he were her own. The neighbor women said, "Now, at last, Naomi has a son again," and they named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse and the grandfather of David.
Great. What translation is that, Kate?
The New Living Translation.
Okay, that makes sense. That's good. I like the New Living Translation. Okay. But they sometimes gloss over some
traditional
implicit parts of the Bible.
Oh.
So there's in verse 16, I think yours said she cared for him as her own. Is that what yours says?
Yeah.
And the literal translation is "and became his nurse."
Mm-hmm.
As in like wet nurse. And that is actually really important to note, because remember in this book, it seems like the blessings that are spoken get expressed or manifested almost immediately, right? So Boaz prays and blesses Naomi or Ruth that she has come to the Lord for protection, and he ends up protecting her, right? In this case, they pray that God will restore Naomi's youth. Right, that was part of your translation. Mine says, "Restore, may He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. Most scholars think that this is an example of, you know, sort of a miracle, right? That Naomi should be well beyond the age where she's nursing children. And yet she becomes the nurse for essentially her grandson, you know, which might seem strange to us, but in the context, it's part of this redemption, right? That she has lost her sons, her husband back in chapter one. And now through this redeemer, she has been given a family again. And it's interesting, the way in which Naomi and Ruth are both these mother figures in the story, if that makes sense, you know?
My version doesn't have any implication of what nursing. Mine is just Naomi loved the boy and took good care of him, which is more like the au pair would be.
Yeah.
Or a grandmother.
Or a grandmother.
It's sort of physically impossible to be a wet nurse unless you have a child of your own and you're nursing it. So I agree completely with Paul.
Well, unless we read it as this, you know, sort of like, you know, lots of times in the Old Testament, women who are barren end up having children, and you know, so is this the blessing that was spoken over Naomi coming to pass immediately?
And the way it's worded in the one I had read during the week was the NASB.
Yeah.
And it says, then Naomi took the child and laid him in her lap and became his nurse. And when you think about how, when you're about to nurse a baby, you lay them in your lap and kind of prepare mm-hmm. yourself, it just, that seems fitting to me.
My NIV Bible says, Naomi took the child and laid him in her lap and cared for him. And it notes that may symbolize she adopted him.
That's what I thought.
And in my study Bible, it says she took the child and laid him in her bosom and became his nurse.
Right.
So my translation goes to the wet nurse, as unrealistic as it might seem to us. That's what Fred does.
Right. Who is a miracle?
Yeah.
But I really wondered what Kathy touched on. Did she adopt this child? Like, it seems like that.
Well, I think this is the interesting part about this, right? Because Ruth is the mom, right?
Right,
right.
Ruth is the one who marries Boaz and gives birth to Obed. And yet Naomi is the one that is sort of the recipient of this restoration and this redemption, you know? So it connects us back to chapter one and our whole question about who is redeemed in this story. I think there's lots of redemption to go around in this story. But it seems like Naomi, this matriarch throughout the story, who I think represents Israel in many ways and the loss that Israel and the grief that Israel went through, is the primary recipient of this redemption and restoration that happens in the story.
I would love to see the Jewish midrash for this story.
Yeah.
Because Naomi is not big in their Hebrew practice. It is Ruth that is carried forth and honored and very important to their lineage, not Naomi. So the different versions are quite striking.
Yeah.
Difference.
You know, there is an argument for the adoption simply because Jewish identity is matrilineal. And since Ruth is a foreigner, Naomi's adoption would make Ruth's son a full member of the Hebrew nation.
That's what I've been thinking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Although, yeah, I think, you know, and there's probably some intentional ambiguity in the story, just like there was with Ruth and Boaz in chapter three. Mm-hmm. She certainly receives him as a son, you know, whether or not she becomes his nurse, whether or not she becomes this mother figure. But in the New Testament, it is Ruth who is the one named, right? So Ruth, Naomi sort of drops off when you get to the genealogy.
I mean, this is a tremendous gift of Ruth to Naomi.
It is.
I mean, she's giving her biological, her son to Naomi. And certainly it's Naomi who's going to raise the child. The neighbors are all looking to Naomi. Nobody is looking at Ruth.
Right.
You know, they're all looking and congratulating, so to speak, Naomi.
Yeah.
And Ruth has made this possible. And Ruth, who gave up her own land and whatever family she had to go with Naomi, I mean, this is a tremendous gift to give your child.
Yeah.
It's a gift. Go ahead.
I was just going to say it's a gift that within this book doesn't end with Ruth. It ends with Naomi.
Yeah.
And yet, as you said, Ruth is the one, if you go into, you know, you go forward the New Testament and into the Jewish, their practices, and it's Ruth that is, you know, it's so very important.
Yeah.
So anyway, she kind of got lost.
It's true. My note, which I think we're working off the same study Bible, Sue, says, you know, not a biological son or even a biological grandson, but a son in that he replaces the family that Naomi has lost. The son represents the continuation of the family. Naomi is the central focus at the end of the story, even as she was at the beginning. So there is this symmetry. Yeah, Sherry.
I was going to say that Ruth is giving her son an incredible gift. And maybe, I know she was giving a gift to Naomi, of course, the baby, but she's giving her son his heritage and his line. Is that correct? Am I seeing it the right way?
Yeah, I think that's part of it.
And that's by adoption. And adoption is very much in the New Testament, as well as the Old Testament.
Yeah.
And we're all adopted children of God and through Jesus, etc. I can't tell you all those things, but I know it's a significant concept.
Well, and it might be one way for the author to sort of make some accommodation for the fact that Naomi's not, or Ruth is not the blood relative, right? So so Naomi sort of stepping into this adoptive role allows there to be also a claim, you know, that you know, this lineage is legit. Because Naomi is an Israelite, Boaz is an Israelite. So even though the birth is through Ruth, who is a foreigner, there is also this intimate connection, and maybe that's further evidence for the wet nurse argument. But yeah, Ian.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I inferred from the text that maybe Naomi had certain legal rights, given that the kinsman redeemer was the relative of her first husband, Elimelech. And this might be one of the reasons why she basically is the adopted mother of this child, because of that thing. The other thing I was going to mention is, since we've found out that a lot of people's names mean something, right? Naomi means pleasant. Mahlon meant disease, I think, or something. Obed, the son's name, is related to the word for serving, according to Strong's lectionary.
Yeah.
Lexicon.
Good. Well, and I also think maybe it gives us further insight into Ruth's character, right? She's strong. She offers herself you know, in both chapter one and chapter two, it is Ruth who takes the initiative to both follow Naomi and then to go out into the field in chapter two. But at the same time, it's never about Ruth, right? And so maybe that's fitting that at the end of the story, it's not about Ruth at the end. You know, she's made this sacrifice to follow Naomi, to go through this, and now to bear a son. But ultimately, it is in service to this higher call, which is the continuation of Naomi's line. So I think it's sort of fitting for Ruth. I also think it's interesting in verse 17 that the women of the neighborhood gave him a name, right? Again, this reinforces this whole idea that it's the women who have the plan here. And I don't have a note and I didn't have time to look it up, but from what I know about Israelite tradition, it would be the man who would name him. And we know this in the Gospel of Luke, right? That Zechariah, they wait for him to speak in order to name John. And everyone assumes they're going to name him Zechariah, but he names him John. So it's very fascinating that the women give him the name and they say a son has been born to Naomi. And then I think if you're listening to this, you know nothing about the story, the very last line, now they named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse, the father of David, and your jaw will drop. I think it should at that point. Because you know nothing about where this is heading until that last line that, and then there's a formal genealogy at the end. Some scholars think that may have been added after the fact to connect it back to Perez. In either way, whether the book ends in verse 17 or verse 22, the last word is David. Yeah. And so in our Christian ordering of the Old Testament books, you know, you turn the page and it's 1 Samuel, where the people say, give us a king. And of course, we know there's a failed king, Saul, who the Lord rejects. And that gives rise to the greatest king Israel will have ever known, David. So in terms of the chronology of the Christian ordering of the Old Testament, that final word is very significant. So it's a great story, isn't it?
It is. It is.
And isn't it so rich to go through it, you know, in depth? I mean, I think most of us knew the story to some degree, but kind of like Jonah, most people know Jonah and the big fish, but when you really read Jonah, it's not about the big fish, right? And the same thing with Ruth. Most people know at some level, if you've heard it, that Ruth pledges this amazing loyalty to Naomi, which certainly is an important part of the story, but that's not the whole story. This is about something much bigger than simply the relationship between Ruth and Naomi. So other thoughts on the book? Where is grace?
Everywhere.
Everywhere.
What is different? What is new about your understanding about grace reading Ruth that maybe you wouldn't have if you just read Jonah or Philippians, the other two books that we read? What's a different lens?
About this one is different in itself because we only have reference to God's blessing at the very end, almost at the end of chapter 4. Nowhere else in the story do we have either a referral to God, a prayer to God. You see the blessing part and the appreciation of what we receive from the Lord in near the end of chapter 4, which is very different.
Okay. Sherry?
To me, and it rings as very important to me, that the grace seems to be consistently given through one person to another person, and the Lord is using somebody to favor, bless, bestow all of these things to another person. So it's the generosity of one person to another, which is, I guess, inspired, I would say, by God.
Yeah, that's a very interesting point. You know, we've made the distinction that in Jonah, all the action or most of the action seems to be directed by Yahweh, right? Mm-hmm. This agency. But here it is sort of passed from person to person, right? The connection with Ruth to Naomi and then Ruth to Boaz and Naomi to Boaz. And yeah, that's interesting.
Right.
Yeah, Marilyn?
Well, also, if you compare the two stories, in both cases, God uses Jonah or uses Ruth. Jonah, even though he disobeys, the blessing goes to the larger community. And in this, because Ruth obeys, the larger community is blessed. So you've got two very different scenarios there.
I think there's the definition of grace, right? In our disobedience and our obedience, God's blessing goes forth. I think that's a great insight. Yeah.
And I look at Ruth's obedience as being sort of a model for what the children of Israel should be.
Yeah.
That they listen. She listens to Naomi, but, and then to Boaz, but she's faithful to the vision and great blessing comes of it. And so this is the best possible look. And of course it's in a foreigner comparing to the stiff-necked people that we saw throughout the Exodus and Joshua, which would have just preceded this story.
Yeah. Right. And of course, you know, the book began with in the time of the judges. So it harkens back to what comes before it immediately and then ends with the name David. So it's a perfect bridge book for this place in the Bible. Yeah, Kate.
So I had this big question. If Naomi is Israel and Boaz is Yahweh, then who's Ruth? But if you listen to what Ian just said, is that might be totally cool if Naomi and Ruth are both Israel and Ruth is this obedient go-getter and kind of like, look what can happen if you walk forward in faith, you know? Of course, you'll always be extended grace, just like Naomi is, but look what can happen when you walk forward in faith.
Yeah, I think that's great. And I think that's a great reminder that it's never kind of one for one in these sort of parable stories where one thing represents one thing in that perfect equivalency. But different characters express and manifest different attributes and characteristics of Yahweh, or in some cases, like Jonah, the not so desirable characteristics. But I think for me, you know, Jonah, the grace in that book is this this persistence on the part of Yahweh to show mercy even to our enemies, even to those that are completely other from us. And despite Jonah's failure and weakness, that mercy and divine imperative goes forward. In Paul's letter to the Philippians, it is about the enabling power that equips us and forms us as the people of God and forms in us the character and likeness of Christ that we saw in chapter 2. We don't do that on our own. That is something that's only possible by the grace of God. And then in Ruth, that same grace is the grace that works through very ordinary human events. The most unlikely of people, many of whom are broken and sinful in their own way. And yet God's plan and providence works through that. Not the other, like the Ninevites, but through these relationships, you know, marriage and friendship and family, mother-in-law and daughter-in-law, these very human relationships, not the global stage, Israel and Ninevites, right? But this domestic setting here, God is working to do amazing things like bring about the greatest king that Israel would ever know. You know what I mean? So I think there are three distinct lenses of grace that we can view these different these different books through. So I hope the whole study has been helpful to you to think about grace in these different ways. Very different books, Jonah, Philippians, and Ruth. And yet I hope by the end you get a sense of how they fit together in painting a picture and giving us an understanding of God's grace in the world and in our lives. So is that good?
Yep.
Okay, so last 5 minutes, how many minutes do we have here? 5 minutes or so? Here's the short answer. I do not have a plan beyond today. So, here's the plan. We're taking 2 weeks off, the 18th and the 25th. We'll come back for 3 weeks in December. So whatever we do in Advent needs to be relatively, you know, concise, because we've got to do it in 3 weeks. Then we'll take 2 weeks off around Christmas and New Year's because of the way the calendar falls. And then we'll come back. Actually, the first Wednesday in January is the Feast of the Epiphany, January 6th. So I really would love to hear from you all about what ideas, books, topics you would like us to consider for the remainder of the year. We still will be on Zoom at least through the end of January, I would imagine. That's our plan. So, ideas, thoughts?
We'll think on it.
Do you want it to be biblical, or are you?
Biblical would be nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
You know, if it's at a wide open field, it
gives So the earlier group, we talked about just continuing on with something like 1 Samuel. We haven't done a gospel in a while. We'll be entering year B, which is mostly focused on the Gospel of Luke. So, no, I'm sorry.
Mark.
Mark. So we thought about studying Mark in year B. Someone suggested a topical study on forgiveness, which I thought was an interesting idea, given everything going on in our world today. Maybe forgiveness and reconciliation as a topical study for 6 or 8 weeks. That would have to start in January. We couldn't do that in three
good
weeks.
Good idea.
So
what about Esther?
I would love to study Esther, yeah. What is the feast day that Esther is associated with in Judaism?
Purim.
Yeah, it's the Feast of the Booths, isn't it?
Yeah.
Does that sound right?
Yeah, when does that take place? I was trying to think if we could.
Right after Yom Kippur. It's right after Yom Kippur.
So we've missed it then.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But that would be a great book to study. Maybe we'll do that one in the spring as well. We'll give some thought to that. I would really love to hear what you're interested in and what you'd like to explore together, because I always get, you know, a lot out of these conversations myself. So I'd love to hear your thoughts.
You know, Advent being a time when we look forward to Jesus coming into the world, and a lot of the like collected canticles, like the third song of Isaiah, to do with light shining in the darkness and things like that. Maybe we could do a topical series during Advent on different representations of light. So we could do the third song of Isaiah, for example, one time, and things like that.
Yeah.
Micah could be done in 3 weeks.
Micah?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's coming up No, Malachi is coming up in the Daily Office lectionary, I think. After Joel, is it Malachi?
Actually, I think you have an intervening Habakkuk there, but yes.
Yeah, Joel, Habakkuk, Malachi. Yes, that's right. That's a good idea, Paul. We could do that. Well, give some thought to that.
I could.
Our theme, so just as I'll give you a short advertisement. I've got to go to a finance committee meeting, but on the first Sunday of Advent, we're going to give out packets to everybody, either if you come to church, or we'll have a drive-through option We're going to be using this devotional that's based on the work of Henry Nouwen, called And the Word Was God. So we're kind of going to focus on Johannine themes in Advent. We tend to think of the Christmas Eve story as the Lucan version, but the prologue of John's Gospel is for Christmas Day. So we're going to kind of focus on that. So there might be some things we could connect. Light would be one of them, Ian, that we could connect. Light is a major Johannine theme. So maybe we could pick up on that as well. But we've got a lot of good things planned for Advent in terms of devotional stuff. We're going to be doing a daily virtual Advent calendar. No chocolate, but lots of inspiration, hopefully, that will be emailing out daily. So short videos from staff and ministry leaders and things like that. So anyway, so if you all have ideas, please send me an email and let me know what you're thinking. And I'd love to put together the calendar for the rest of the year based on what you all would like to follow. So. It's-